Hi all. Well, today we're going to be talking about some vector calculus topics. What's the curl of a vector field? So the curl of the vector field B is usually written in terms of the vector differential operator del and the vector cross product with the vector field B. Now we can write these two factors out here. We have I d by dx plus j d by dy k d by dz, and these I, j, k's are the Cartesian constant I, j, k unit vectors that obey I dot I equals 1, and I dot j or I dot k is 0, so they are orthogonal and of unit length. Moreover, they do not depend on the location in the manifold. If you have a curvilinear coordinate system, like spherical polar coordinates or cylindrical polar coordinates, the basis vectors can be orthogonal and normalized to unity, but they do depend on position. And so that means you have to be careful if you have position-dependent basis vectors. And here's why. Let's just look at the problem of taking the derivative of the vector I times bx. So this is a vector that points in the x direction, points in the direction of the basis vector I, and its length varies with position and time. So if we take this derivative, we have the derivative of a product, and so you have to use the product rule for differentiation. So the first term would be di by dx times bx. The second term would be vector I dbx dx. And since we've chosen these vectors that do not depend on position, this di by dx term vanishes. That's very unusual. Mostly we're dealing with more generalized coordinate systems where there is maybe curvature or even time dependence to the basis vectors. In that case, you have to add another term here to get the correct value of the derivative. So what we're going to do in this video is show how you can calculate curl of B by just the rules of the cross products of the I, J, K basis vectors. You know, once you know the cross products of I, J, and K pairwise, then you can calculate the cross product of any pair of vectors. So we're going to write down a multiplication table for I, J, K and the cross product. I know there are lots of memory tricks like using your right hand and drawing a little orthogonal triad like this kind of IJK, and by all means use those if you find them helpful. We're going to follow this through and take a more algebraic approach and just write down a multiplication table for the cross products. Okay, so I've written out the multiplication table for cross products between the basis vectors I, J, and K here with I, J, and K. Now I cross I is 0, J cross J is 0, K cross K is 0, so the diagonal consists of zeros, and these are vectors, so these are the zero vectors. So this vector has coordinates 0, 0, 0 in the Cartesian orthogonal system. If you wanted to know what is J cross K, well, you'd read that off by going J cross K, and that's equal to I right over here, and so on. So once we have this multiplication table for the basis vectors, we're in a position to calculate the curl of the vector field B, and B is going to depend in general on the coordinates in the Cartesian space, and t is a time parameter. And in this treatment, we are looking at the space-time, you know, the conception of what is physical space in Maxwell's theory. We're going to consider that as the topological product of the Euclidean manifold E3 of the coordinates x, y, z with a one-dimensional topological manifold that is the time coordinate. So in this picture, the time is an element of the real numbers, and we consider this a one-dimensional linear space where the basis vector is 1 second. So there's kind of a basis vector for time. I don't know, what could we call that? Maybe tau. But this space of T is endowed with the standard neighborhood topology of the real numbers, and therefore we can construct continuous and differentiable functions on T. So we can take time derivatives and check that the functions, that the fields are continuous in the T variable. But time does not have any geometric significance. We're not using a Minkowski metric. We're not considering this Minkowski space. And this is a perfectly good way of doing classical vector calculus, where you have a three-dimensional Euclidean manifold, and the Euclidean metric for x, y, and z coordinates. And then we can have a parameter time. Okay. Now, of course, the curl and divergence operators only affect the components of the fields that are in E3. There is no field component in the time direction. Later on, we'll find out that Maxwell's equations are also relativistically correct, and therefore you can construct vectors and write down the Maxwell's equations in a manifestly covariant way, and the space is then space-time 4, where you have a semi-Riemann manifold, and we're allowing vectors to have imaginary lengths, and the metric is not positive definite. But that's for later. We don't need to do special relativity yet, and Maxwell's equations can be, you can use them your whole life, and you don't need to leave this simplified space where time has no geometric significance. It's purely a topological, non-geometric, one-dimensional manifold. And this cross product is viewed as the topological product between E3 and T1. Okay, a little bit of manifold jazz in here. Okay, so we have this multiplication table, and we're going to go ahead and write out the components of this differentiation by the differential operator del. So let's take a look at that, the next slide. Okay. We also are going to need this vector identity. Divergence of the curl of B is equal to the scalar 0. And we'll see how that comes about as well. Okay, so let's write this out. Del cross B. Write out del over here. And write out the magnetic field. And take the cross product. Now, I've written the multiplication table here. So let's start with the first term here crossed into these three terms of B. So you have an I cross J, dBy dx, I cross K, d by dx of BZ. And if we look this up in the table, I cross K is minus J. So here's a minus J. That's this one is minus J. And I cross J, everybody knows that, that's plus k. So k is the unit vector in the z direction. So this term crossed into the vector field B gives you a vector, and it has two terms in it. It has a k term and a minus j term that are dy dx and dby dx and dbz dx. Okay. The next term is J d by dy. J d by dy is the middle term of this del factor. Cross J d by dy cross the vector field B. So you have J cross I dbx dy, J cross K dby dz. And using the multiplication table, You get minus k for the first cross product and plus I for the second. And notice that there's kind of a symmetry showing up, or a cyclic behavior showing up in all these individual terms. The curl, cross product of del with B. So there's a unit vector that's pointing in, say, the z direction, and then you have a derivative with respect to y of bx. So you get an x, y, and z in this term. And you notice every term has that feature, that if the basis vector points in some direction, say I, then the derivatives are, and the derivative is in another direction, and the magnetic field is in the third direction. I won't give any physical interpretation of that, but it's something to watch. And finally, we have the third term, k d by dz cross the vector field b. And so you have k cross I. K cross I is what? It's plus j. There it is. And k cross j is minus I. So there it is right here. The curl of b gives you six terms, each of which is a vector field, and they're added together. Now, this has a rather simple physical interpretation. You can kind of come up with a geometric interpretation. Why do you get all these terms in the cross product of del and b? Okay, so now we can combine. Notice that there are repeated instances of the vector I and j and k here. So we can combine terms with like basis vectors. And that's what we have in the next page here. We have the curl of B. Okay, I guess I've messed up our nice formula here. Now, what can we say about this besides... Okay, so I mentioned this earlier. If we have curvilinear coordinates, you can still group all of these together in terms of the basis vectors, but there are additional terms that show up in the curl, because you have derivatives of these position-dependent basis vectors. But when you take those derivatives, you can express the result still in terms of the position-dependent basis vectors. So it takes a little bit more vector algebra to get the right formula for the curl, let's say, in spherical polar coordinates. And if you haven't seen that before, check it out in mathematical tables, and you'll see that the curl has a much more complicated looking formula than what we have here for Cartesian coordinate and orthogonal unit basis. Okay, so now, so this is how you calculate the curl. And notice that we've done this algebraically from the multiplication table, and you do not need to check your right-hand rule or whatever other visual aids that people like to use. So this is maybe a little bit cleaner way of doing it from a mathematical standpoint. Now we're going to do the next part of the video, which is how do you calculate divergence of the curl, this notation where I use the carets over manifold related quantities, and then the arrows are for the physics vector fields. And notice that the vector B exists in the tangent bundle over E3. So, you know, we can call that TE3, and it's going to be a tangent bundle for the vector field B. So if you view B as a vector field, that's considered a section of the tangent vector, tangent bundle of all points in E3, and at each point in E3 we attach another three-dimensional manifold that has B in it. So there's sort of a entire space that's devoted to the magnetic field in Tesla. So B, you know, B has units of Tesla, but points in the Euclidean manifold E3, if P is an element of E3, its coordinates are x, y, z, and these things are in meters. So you are going to be unsuccessful if you try to shove this Tesla into the coordinate manifold E3. So the way this is done is that for every point in E3, we attach a vector space that's devoted entirely to the vector B. And there's a similar vector space for E. So there's quite a bit of structure that's superimposed on the space, physical space, E3 cross T1, space-time. Okay, well, since we have worked these out, the easiest way to proceed is just to go ahead and now calculate the dot product of del with this vector right here. Okay, so we've written down the dot product of del with curl B, and you can see that the unit vectors I, J, and K will annihilate each other when the dot product is taken. So we're going to end up with the d by dx derivative of the first term in the cross product, the d by dy derivative of the second term in the cross product, and the d by dz derivative of the last term in the cross product. So we'll have second partial derivatives in this dot product. Now, let's go ahead and write these out. Maybe we should speed up this part of the video, but it doesn't really take very long. I'll be writing down the derivatives of curl B term by term. There are terms with plus and minus signs. And there are three terms with plus signs and three terms with minus signs. So when we take the second partial derivatives, work out the explicit form of each of these terms, looks like we might have a good chance that they'll start canceling out. So let's see how that works. So we'll just wait a moment here while we go ahead and take the second partial derivatives of the bx, by, bz in each term of the curl of B. Now, one of the properties of analytic functions is that you can interchange the order of partial differentiation. So you can write second partial bx of by dy by dz as second partial of bx by dz b dy. A lot of D's, B's, and E's here. So the second partial derivatives, and you can see that there's a correspondence between positive and negative terms of second partial BZ. And what do you know? They are equal in magnitude, but opposite in sign. And so the difference between these two terms is zero. Look, there you go. That's equal to zero too. You have the second partial of by by dx and dz. And we rearrange the order of the differentiation and get zero. And we add them up. And the final one is second partials of bx with respect to y and z. And there you go. The zero scalar is the sum of all these terms. So this proves that the divergence of the curl of any vector field is the scalar zero. This vector identity, even though we've derived it in a specific coordinate system, the orthogonal Cartesian XYZ coordinates on E3, because we've written this in vector form, the identity divergence of curl B is true in any valid coordinate system on E3. We're going to use this identity to show that electric charge conservation is implied by Maxwell's equations. Okay.
Well, I hope you enjoyed this longer calculation type video.